Welcome to the show. I'm David Begno. 12 noon in New York, 9 a.m. on the West Coast. Thanks for joining us. Acting Defense Secretary Patrick Shanahan says he's looking to free up some funds to use at the southern border following President Trump's national emergency declaration. Mr. Shanahan says this could be done by delaying or even canceling other projects. Here's what Shanahan said about the efforts on Saturday.
For a number of weeks now, we've been laying out the process we would follow if a national emergency were declared, and making sure everybody understands the statutes so that we could do things correctly and legally. The language itself is very simple. I think, in effect, it says to support military operations, you have the discretion to utilize military construction funds. And it's basically that broad.
So this comes after the president agreed to a spending deal last week. The bipartisan compromise prevented another partial government shutdown. Mr. Trump declared a national emergency shortly after because the bill contained billions less than what he requested for the barrier at the border. Our check on the Sunday morning talk show starts today with some reaction to the president's national emergency decision.
We already have 4,000 troops on the border in light of the national emergency, a decision that was made almost a year ago, as we've seen an increasing number of people crossing the border, as well as increasing violence in Mexico. What the president was saying is that, like past presidents, he could choose to ignore this crisis, choose to ignore this emergency, as others have, but that's not what he's going to do.
Do you think the national emergencies law should be fixed?
Well, I think...
Or does that limit future presidents?
I think it could limit future presidents. Now it's up to the legislative branch to do our job, to sit down and have a discussion whether or not we want to do that. But perhaps there is more need for clarity so that this type of abuse does not happen in the future.
I think many of us are concerned about this. I think past Congresses have given any executive, any administration, way too much power, and this would be another expansion of that power. That's why you see an awful lot of us concerned about this. Now, the better way to solve this problem would be for Democrats to support what they supported in the past and give this president funding for better barriers, which we need.
If we give away, if we surrender the power of the purse, which is our most important power, there will be little check and no balance left. It'll not be a separation of powers anymore, just a separation of parties. So this is going to be a moment of truth for my GOP colleagues.
Let's bring in David Nakamura. He's a White House reporter at The Washington Post. Happy Sunday.
Hi, David.
So what are the options that the Democrats have to fight the president's declaration?
Well, you know, you're already seeing Democrats in the states, including California, say they're going to be looking into ways to stop this through lawsuits in the courts. And some of those have already been filed by interest groups. The California state attorney general has said he will work with groups to launch their own attempt to block this in the courts. But you also see on Capitol Hill, certainly, an attempt possibly by House Democrats to hold a vote, basically to deny the president the ability and to overturn this national emergency. There is a provision in which Congress can vote to overturn it. However, that would require Senate approval. And so a House vote to do so with mostly Democratic votes would then require a vote in the Senate. And that's where the sticking point comes. It's not clear now that Senate Majority Leader McConnell has said he's endorsed this to Trump, whether the Senate would go ahead and attempt to stop this. But I think you're going to see politically Democrats move quickly to do something.
So numerous Republicans have come out in support of the president. Here's what Lindsey Graham said today on Face the Nation.
What disappoints me is on President Obama's watch, as a Republican, I voted for a $44 billion border security package, $9 billion of which included barriers. Hmm. 2006, all of us voted for the Secure Fence Act. And we're talking about steel barriers, not a concrete wall. And unfortunately, when it comes to Trump, the Congress is locked down and will not give him what we've given past presidents. So unfortunately, he's got to do it on his own, and I support his decision to go that route.
So, David, given the fact that people like Ron Johnson don't think it's a good idea, how crucial is it to have folks like Lindsey Graham? And who are the other Grahams that are behind the president on this issue?
Well, look, I mean, Lindsey Graham's important for President Trump in that. I guess Lindsey Graham was somebody who supported, you know, broad, bipartisan, comprehensive immigration reform under President Obama, under President Bush. And he talked a little bit about there. What he didn't mention was that efforts to provide walls and other barriers during those past presidencies also went forward with that broader discussion of other ways to fix the system. Trump is narrowly focused on this wall, and he's relying on support to some degree from the Lindsey Grahams, who are sort of more moderate. But he's also facing, you know, a significant Republican pushback from lawmakers in Texas who fear the use of eminent domain to seize the land, who don't like the idea of a president overstepping constitutional authority to do this in their mind. I think the president is more looking at the support from the conservative wing in the Mark Meadows and the Freedom Caucus and other conservatives, certainly, you know, thought leaders in the media. From Sean Hannity to others who might support this idea as a win for his base and something that that overrides any kind of middle ground, even if this idea of a wall or even a move to use emergency powers to do so is broadly unpopular.
You know, Nancy Pelosi, the House Speaker, raised the possibility of the president setting something of a precedent. How worried are Democrats about this when it comes to the precedent they set, and maybe not worried, but excited and what they could do with it down the road?
They might see an opportunity. You know, look, this is something that I think some Republicans have said. You know, they accused President Obama and even President Trump, who was then, you know, private citizen Donald Trump, accused President Obama of abusing executive authority, of going around Congress, of being an emperor.
He tweeted about it. Yeah,
he tweeted about it on several issues, but especially on immigration. President Obama tried to do a big, deferral of deportations for millions of people. That got struck down in the courts. But Republicans criticized that, and now you are seeing some Republicans concerned about the precedent this sets. You're seeing Democrats, as you say, they might say broadly, "Well, we were concerned about the overstep of powers," but if the president is going to do this, we're going to pocket that idea and fight it now, but also potentially use it in the future. If he's setting this precedent on things from gun control, as Nancy Pelosi suggested, to climate change, issues that they believe are bigger and more serious crises and emergencies that need to be addressed.
Do I get the sense that Republicans are a little worried by that?
Certainly, there are. There are a number of Republicans who believe it is a bad precedent. Many spoke out. You know, among them was Senate Majority Leader McConnell, who said repeatedly he did not believe this was the right way to go. He did not support the president doing an emergency declaration. They sort of closed down the government with a shutdown for 5 weeks. McConnell warned against doing this emergency, but he feared another potential shutdown and decided that it was more important to keep the government open and allow Trump to go forward with this measure. So that's why you're seeing McConnell endorse that. And that could put the Senate Republicans in a really difficult vote here. As I mentioned, if Democrats in the House do go forward with this resolution to overturn the emergency and force the Senate Republicans to vote on it.
All right, so let's talk about the president's tweet today. Big progress, he said, is being made with China to reach a trade agreement. The deadline to reach a deal is March 2nd. Does it look like that's achievable at this point?
It seems
against a deadline.
It seems unlikely. And, you know, it seemed to be setting up where President Trump wanted to meet with President Xi of China before that March 1st deadline. He said, "I'm going to do it on my Asia trip," which is going to be the summit with Kim Jong-un in about a week and a half. That did not come together. It's hard to do two big summits like that, schedule that at the same time. They're not going to be able to meet ahead of time. So it probably is unlikely they can strike a full deal on trade before that. The question is, the White House has signaled they could extend the deadline if they seem to be making good progress. I think that could be the likely outcome here. The president said in the Rose Garden the other day that he loves tariffs and, you know, he believes in them and that they have the power to shift behavior. But he also seemed to be signaling that progress is going forward on a deal. He even said that at some point, if he strikes a deal, Democrats will be against it, signaling that he seems like they're on the path for a deal. And he said he was thinking about bringing Democratic leaders into the room on a final deal so that they could have sort of buy-in ahead of time. I don't know that is a smart way to go, but I do think it's unlikely you're going to see a deal by March 1st, and whether you get that extension of time to allow negotiators to keep talking before Trump and Xi meet at some point, maybe to lock down the deal. I think that seems to be the likely path.
Let's talk North Korea. When does the president go to Vietnam to meet with Kim Jong-un, and is the White House prepared for that? I mean, I haven't heard much about it.
The president is going on February 26th. It's been overshadowed by all these other items. And, you know, the White House team is being led by Steve Biegun as the lead negotiator at the State Department. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo said Biegun and his team would be going back out to meet with North Korean negotiators any day now, possibly this weekend, possibly early next week, to nail down the final details. They had one round of talks in Pyongyang just a week ago. They didn't finish everything up. They announced Hanoi as the final site, but there's still important sticking points over exactly what the agenda is and what they can accomplish and agree to in the two-day summit, which is February 27th and 28th. That is what's really pressing right now, is to try to figure out ways they can actually make some sort of deal go beyond just sort of symbolic, which we saw in Singapore, to much more detailed path toward taking steps toward some sort of denuclearization effort in Hanoi.
The U.S. and Taliban negotiators are going to start, we're going to resume their talks on Monday. They're brokering a peace deal in Afghanistan. Where does that stand?
This seems also kind of in flux in that, you know, the president has made clear that he'd like to remove U.S. troops from Afghanistan in the way that he's also talked about from Syria. But, you know, the idea that these next round of talks could be held in Pakistan is very interesting in that Pakistan has been a wild card and an important alternative party in the talks between the U.S., Taliban and the Afghan government. You know, you'd want some buy-in from Pakistan not to sort of upset any kind of tentative plan to provide a peace deal. But it's also, you know, leaves open questions about exactly what motives Pakistan has here and what agenda they have. And so I think a lot is still up in the air. And right now for President Trump, even though he signaled that he wants an end game here, I think the negotiators have a lot of work to do in the same way that they do with North Korea.
And to be clear, they're meeting in Pakistan. That's where it's happening.
Absolutely.
David Nakamura, thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot.